Everybody don't holler. All at the
same time. What can you do?
What can the two say? So he is alluding to the fact that in his father's house. And he is talking about, certainly he is talking about heaven. And I don't know if I shared this when we first read this, but there are so many aspects of what Jesus taught, and so many of you already know this anyway. So many aspects of how our Lord taught had to do with things that his hearers were familiar with. In particular, that Solomon built up. Part of building the temple, which is God's house, as it were, there were many chambers that were a part of the temple complex. And so Jesus says, with regard to what they understand and how they know that the temple was built with many different chambers, he says, greater than this earthly house, if you will, in my Father's house, there are many, many rooms. And they would be familiar with that with regard to the earthly temple. Okay? How do you get to his Father's house? How do you get to?
14 and 6
says what?
I am the way.
Jesus told the people that I came out from the Father, they immediately wanted to pick up Because he was saying that he was God. When he said that I and the Father are one, they wanted to pick up rocks. Because they were saying that his essence, I mean, he was saying that in essence, he was divine. None of us in here, in our essential, in our essence, is divine. God created us.
Okay.
And such as it is, even when it came to in the Gospel of Luke, when the angel comes and tells Mary, says, "You're gonna have a baby," and she goes, "Well, how can I have a baby? I don't know no man." He says, "The Holy Spirit is going to overshadow you, and the power of the Most High." What is that? And here's the answer to that. Any man, what is that? And anybody that tells you that they know the answer, you need to beat feet up out of there. It is a mystery. But Jesus has always been with the Father. And that's why he prays, and we're going to get to that. He says, "Father, I pray that you would give me the glory which I had with you from eternity." And again, give me the glory which I had with you from eternity. See? So when Jesus becomes a man, now watch this. When God becomes a man, he is lesser than. Watch this. Thank you, Lord. When the Son, who is eternal, becomes a man, and the Father, who is eternal, never becomes a man. Watch this now. Even in this sense, the Father is greater than the Son. That's right. Because the Father has never changed. But the Son became a man. The Son could die and would die, but the Father never dies. In that sense, he is greater than the Son. Jesus is in his natural body when he says, "Be glad that I say I'm going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I." Well, in what way is he greater? He never became a man. He never suffered a bed. He never died. So the greatness that Jesus is talking about when he says, "My Father is greater than I," it has to do with not his essence, not his godness, as it were. It has to do with who he was as the Son. He is God, the Son. Pay attention to the language. You'll never hear any other somebody, even if they were sent from God. And see now, the Father never got sent anywhere. But the Son got sent by the Father. And it was not of coercement now. And that's why we read in the Psalms, "Prepare thou me a body." So then he volunteered. Good God Almighty. Jesus volunteered
Father is the source. He is the source from which comes the Son. He is the source from which comes the Holy Ghost. No, yes, ma'am, go ahead.
So he also sent the Holy Spirit too, according to you.
Amen.
25.
That's right.
The Father will send in my name.
That's right. Now, okay, now watch this. And she makes a point that we're going to call. And that's how come Jesus, the Son of God, doesn't talk like a subordinate of sorts. That's why the language goes back. Watch this. At one point, he wants you to know that he and the Father are one. He and the Holy Spirit are one. The Holy Spirit and the Father, they are one. How? And the answer is, That's above your pay grade. But God has always been. He is in theology they call him the first cause. The first cause. In other words, God causes things. Well, why is a thing caused God? And that's why, even in trying to tell Moses said, well, who should I tell him? Send me down here. That man, that tetragrammaton. What now? It is, I'm undescribable. You don't have any language that can properly express me. And that's how come I sent myself through my Son, so that you could see me. Because your natural eyes, listen, that's how come the Bible is, Moses said to God, he said, Lord, let me look at your glory. I want to see you. This is Moses said, God said. He said, no, Moses, I can't let you do that. If you look on me, I'll have to kill you.
Yeah.
I'm paraphrasing. But he said, if you look at me, I'll have to. He said, but now what I'm going to do? I'm getting ready. I was going to preach this. Watch this. Moses said, let me see you. And peculiarly enough, on the mountain where they were, there was a little place cut in the side of the mountain.
Right.
And it just happened to be the same size as Moses.
Right.
God said, I can't let you look at me.
Yes.
But you can look at my behind. Watch this. He said, now to look at me, you got to get up in that. Yeah. Ergo, the hill, rock of ages.
Yes,
by the hand of God,
yes.
So that Moses could slide in.
Yes.
God. Oh, cut me a rock. Mm-hmm. Slide up in there.
Right.
And he said, you see that? Lord have mercy.
Yeah.
I'm gonna preach it anyway.
Clean?
Paul says, by the washing of regeneration of the Holy Ghost. So then, the Word of God will clean you up. Is that right?
Okay, but I've given the word on everybody.
That's it. He says, now mind you, Jesus is not dead, is he?
No.
This is Jesus talking, isn't it?
Yes.
But he tells his disciples that you are clean when? The present tense is already. Is he dead?
No.
Has there any blood been shed?
No.
So how the world will be clean? You are clean already. That's what he says. He says, you are clean already, and he tells them why. Because of the word which I've spoken to you. Is that right?
Yes.
But now, it's not just about because I've spoken it to you, but listen, because I said, hey, believe in, because I said, but now, something must occur after the word is spoken.
Right.
The cleaning doesn't take place just because he spoke it. But what he spoke did something in you. And the moment it does in you, you are clean already. See? Now here. Live in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. In other words, I'm explaining this to you, he's saying. The branch cannot bear fruit of itself. The only way that the branch can bear fruit is that it lives in the
vine.
Is that right?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I am the vine, and you are the what?
Branches.
Now watch this. It's actually really not known exactly where this discourse takes place. But it is believed by so many scholars that when Jesus was teaching this, he was near one of the main entrances of the temple. And at one of the main entrances, there's a gate called Beautiful there. You may read about the Beautiful Gate in Scripture. Well, at what the Scripture calls the Beautiful Gate, that was an illustration of a great grapevine, just beautifully brazen metal, a beautiful illustration of what the grapevine looks like, with clusters here, clusters there, clusters, and it's believed that Jesus, using that illustration, which was right before his hearers, are able to really get with him, so to speak. He says, because now the vine that's illustrated with regard to the entrance to the temple, that vine was illustrative of the people of God. It was, for Israel was God's vine. And if you would actually, we don't have one. Well, if you go to Hosea chapter 10, verse 1, Isaiah chapter 5, verse 1, Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 20, verse 22. If you go to Ezekiel chapter 15, verse 2, 19, 10. If you go to Hosea chapter 10, verse 1, go to Isaiah chapter 5, verse 1. You go to Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter 15, verse 2, 3. Ezekiel chapter 19. and the like. What you're going to find is that, in particular, you'll read the verses in Isaiah. God says, what happened to my beautiful vine that I planted? I planted a vine that was supposed to be so luscious and beautiful, and now you've grown into producing these nasty, bitter grapes. What happened to my pleasant plant, he calls it, in Isaiah? So and so. So then, what I'm bringing you to is Israel failed to be God's pleasant plant. That's why Jesus comes along and says, I am the vine. Right? And some translations say, I am the true vine. I'm the real vine. And you are the branches. He who abides in me, and I in him. Now, watch this, y'all. Y'all pay attention? Pay attention? For the so-called saint that says, for the professed saint that says, I know I love the Lord. And I may not do A, B, C, D, E, F, G, but I know that I love the Lord. You hear? This is what Jesus said. I hear what you say. This is what Jesus said. He who lives in me and I live in him, now watch this. I don't want you to get caught up on much aspect of it. Jesus tells a story, the gospel record, Matthew's account in particular. Jesus tells a story of a man that went out planting seed. I remember that. Well, at the planting of the seed, a lot of plants came up. And this is what Jesus says. Different plants yielded different amounts of produce. He says some produce 60, some produce 40, some produce 100. Y'all got me?
Right.
Now, if you take what I want to say, some produce 60, some produce 40, some produce 100, so well, not. For that particular plant, 40 was 100. For that particular plant. For one thing, that particular plant couldn't hold all the fruit that this plant produced. Another plant produced 60. Well, for that plant, 60 was 100. So the 100 producer there, you don't judge the 60 and the 40 by your produce. Because watch this. Paul says, one man watered, another man planted seed, but it's God that gives the increase. So if you want to blame God for the, want to blame somebody. So then, when he says, but what you need to know, you're not the determining factor as to what you produce. Right. It's not for you to say, well, I'm not the Reverend Bishop, Dr.
God's not expecting me to. I don't have to know the word of God like that. I'm not going to be standing before anybody, you know. That's not your call. Because see, the 60 plan, the 40 plan, and the 100 plan, they all got the same commandments.
But the bottom line, what I want you to bear in mind is, don't so much. It's not for you to determine what the much is. Okay? But God knows what much is for you. See? He knows what your much is. And he, watch this, God is satisfied that you are producing much fruit.
Much for you.
Bottom line is, you're going to produce if you are in Him. Okay? Without me, you can do what?
Nothing.
Without me, you can do what?
Nothing.
And especially with that, first of all, you can't do, you really can't do anything without God. I mean, even if you're stealing, you're stealing using His air, His, right, using His grace. God is letting you steal. Sure enough, He can do that. You know how come God can let folks steal and rob and pillage and all of that? Because eternity is not in time. God made time. There was no time before God made it. God is going, and He's going. Woo! That's our Father. He made time and then put us in it. If anyone, watch this, if anyone, you're not going to make it off your mama's prayers, your sister's prayers, your cousin's prayers, the bishop, reverend, doctor, apostle, right, reverend prayers, you're not. And no ma'am or no sir, I am not putting down praying for one another. We ought to pray for one another. Jesus told Peter, He says, Peter, I have prayed for you. Right? So then, but what it's talking about is that He also told Peter, now I have prayed for you, but now when you get converted. Jesus prayed for Peter, and it was yet to be converted. But He did have a word. He said, Jesus said, don't worry about Peter. I got you. I prayed for you. Lord have mercy. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out. And He says, like they do branches. That's what He says. He is cast out. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out. And now, when this happens, that's God's business. There is a day coming that this is going to happen to everybody. Yeah. Now somebody said, but when is that day? Well, for some of us, it could be today. Mm. Do y'all hear me? He is cast out as a branch. And his hearers understand what he's saying because they've witnessed this all of their lives. It's a part of how they, it's part of their culture. The harvesting and the pruning and the nurturing of vineyard and what the grape in particular meant to them. He says he's cast out. As a branch and is withered. It dies away. And another thing too is, what's in this language is a process. The branch that is cast out, the anyone that is cast out like the branch, you will notice that this is actually in the language. Well, when the branch is cut off from the vine, it doesn't immediately die. Mm-hmm. that the world was made for Christ and by him and through him. All of that language. It was made for him, it was made by him, and it was made through him. So that all of creation is related to Christ. He's God. Okay? There's a process for those that would be separate from the life that is God. There is a withering taking place right now. Because there are folk that will refuse, like the example that we have in this text. Judas refused the life that Jesus offered. Washing his feet. Come on, Judas. Come on, Judas. So what the Lord, what God wants us to have about ourselves is, there are some people that God can do the utmost for, and he did the utmost by giving his son. But they will continually refuse his love. And it's a sorry state of faith. And it's with them. And they gather them and throw them into the fire. And the day that they're talking about, particularly talking about the day they gather the branches, the folk that do that. You understand? The folk that do that, when the branch is cast forth, well, they gather it up and they take it to the fire. Because what they found in antiquity is that a grapevine was good for nothing. Productive. Unless it was attached to a vine producing grapes. They couldn't use it to build. They couldn't use it to eat. They couldn't use it to wear. And so immediately when they cut those unproductive branches off, they didn't bother to try to, you know, maybe threaten or weave. Because undoubtedly that had been tried and it was too brittle once it dried or something. I don't know. But they found that grape vines are good for nothing except producing grapes. Yeah. Now, woo! Here I is. Yeah. It does the adversary no good to mess with me. Cause I know my diction is all jacked. I know, but my sister, I ain't good for nothing.
Right.
Except producing for the Lord.
don't get all deep and religious. Man, you know, I just want to serve the Lord. I just want to do God's will. No. What it's talking about, though, is that when the Word of God abides in you, and that is, it's living in you, the Bible says that we are not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, because it is the power of God that can bring salvation. Well, the Word of God is alive, the Bible says. It's living. And it's sharper. Than any two-edged sword. And even in that text, it says it's sharper than any two-edged sword. Well, see now, they knew what a two-edged sword that's sharp on this side, a sword that's sharp on that side, so that it cuts going this way. And you ain't got to turn it around so that the blade can slide. But it cuts going this way, and this whack him. He's letting you know that he ain't talking about no okie dokie blade. For this blade can kill. Watch this. It's a spiritual blade. But watch this here. But it doesn't know that it's only spiritual. That's how come it can come and cut and slice in the natural and the supernatural. It's eating it. You know, and now you know, can't know, you know, I can't see God's word. And you can't, sure you can see. You look at this word. The wages of sin is death. You don't see it? But when the word is alive in you, your desires conform to it. When the word of God is alive in you, that supernatural word of God controls this natural. Paul says about himself, he said, I buffet myself. He said, my body, this thing here wants to do what it do. He said, but Paul says, thanks be to God.
Yes.
That I've got something.
Yes.
Watch this, that can rule this.
Yes.
And your natural mind, your great amount of intelligentsia, your academic prowess, your hearty tautiness is not enough to control the heart. For the Bible says, Jeremiah says, that he, God knows in the heart that this heart is what? Woo! Not just wicked, desperately wicked. But the word will do something to your desire. And anything that the word does to your desire will be done. Anything that the word does to your desire, it's going to be done. By this my Father is glorified. What do you mean? By this my Father. By what? By this my Father is glorified. By what? My Father is glorified. By this my Father is glorified. Well, he has to be. So then, fruit glorify God. Mm. Don't tell the world that you glorify
by those fruit? Yeah. So you will be my disciples. My disciples bear much fruit. You know, it wasn't my. As the Father, watch this here. And Sister Young was asking about. You say, well, why does it sound like that's in the past tense then? He says, as my Father loved me, right? As my Father loved me, I also have, watch this, what? Loved you. Now, what this is doing is, what Jesus is saying here, my Father loves me and he showed it. That's what it's not, you know, that he used to love me. My Father loved me, and he showed it, and he is showing it, right? The tense here. My Father loved me. So with Jesus, how you know that the Father loved me? Because everything I did, it blew up. Turn up. Everything I did. When I laid hands on the sick.
Yeah, yeah.
When I spoke to you. When I took the bread and fishes in my hand, it blew up. My Father loved me.
Yes.
Because all that I did with my mouth, with my hands, it gave fruit unto his glory. And you saw it, and he's saying to folk that witnessed, he said, you saw it, didn't you? He said, just like my Father showed that he loved me by what he did through me, I also loved you. All that you ever did that was truly glorifying God, you need to know that that didn't come from you. And that brings me, peculiar enough, I have a letter, I was debating whether or not I was going to read it during morning worship. And I was chewing on it, but it ended me. This past Sunday, I got a letter from an inmate at Centralia prison, and but here, the brother, he said, it says on the letter, please read this to your congregation.
Bible.
Say again.
One of those side pockets.
But as we're to this point here, listen to me. When I read that, brothers, it just broke me down. Something terrible. I didn't want it to appear as though I was tooting my own horn. By bringing this particular testimony of this brother, but this weird as all get out. I didn't know we were gonna wind up here. But I was talking to one of my deacons, and I said, brother, I wish I could read it for you, right? Yeah, well, I don't. But here's the thing. What this man shares in his letter is this. He says, we have other people that come up here. He said, but there's something about being in worship with you. He said, read this to your congregation, he said, but because he is no longer talking to me in the letter. So yeah, so he is no longer talking to me, but he is talking to you. And it's not so much as it is about me. It's about what one somebody can do in the lives of one other somebody. Do you know that brother said? He says, you help us to realize our worth. I said, why? He said, I'm better. I'm better. He said, he was a Muslim. Now he's taking seminary classes online. So I ain't studying. You listen to it. And what I mean by that is, it is never for us to put a timeline of limitation on what God can do and does in His own time. So you study the Word of God. Study. And though your study may be to you a 20 and a 30, for God, at that particular juncture of your spiritual sojourn, of your spiritual journey, that's your 100.
Yes.
And what God never accepts 99 and a half. Never. For almost, Paul was talking to King Agrippa. Paul told him the story of how Jesus came to him and knocked him off of his mount there and how he met the Lord. And Agrippa said, "Why, man, you almost convinced me." Well, you need to know, Agrippa, that almost saved is still lost. Hey, Agrippa. 99 and a half is still lost. I don't know if I'm gonna read that thing. I may read it. But it blessed my soul. And I pray that such aspects of it, what it really means, is that God is working in the hearts and minds of these men. And I pray God, I tell them all the time, I call all y'all to live around here. I say, but now you can stop going back. See, let a brother know that you. On your way home. I look forward to the day. And I pray that you will too. Because God is able to keep them from falling and to present them faultless before the presence of His glory with exceeding joy.
heads with them. Father, we thank you for this time that you have shared. I thank you for the knowledge that if we are living in you, you are producing in us. You are producing through us. And help us just to be grateful for whatever you choose to do through these vessels, through these plants of yours. Allow us to be branches and grateful to produce. Put on with us from this week, as you have times past. Careful we are to thank you, Lord, for the honor, the glory, for all of yours anyhow. In Jesus' blessed name. They all said amen.
Amen.
All right, y'all.